So indeed, there has been a perception for quite some time, especially among not just the Westerners, among even the educated middle class Hindus, that Tantra is something very divine, something that is offbeat, something that is perhaps a kind of, not mainstream. Obviously, it is not mainstream in some senses, but it's not entirely away from the Hindu fold at all. So before we go into understanding how it is practiced today and things like that, we need to understand a bit of the history that how it evolved in the first place. So initially, perhaps around, the maybe second or third century AD or thing around that time. So one of the, in fact, not one, there were two specific areas where Tantra as a kind of a practice, which is different from the mainstream Vedic practice, evolved. One was in Kashmir, and the other, there was a parallel development in Eastern India around the what is known as around the temple of Kamakhya. So these were the two places. So initial stages, Tantra was basically a new method of ritual. There is a Vedic method of ritualism. Because at the end of the day, philosophy is one thing for any kind of practice, whether it's mainstream, any of the Vedantic fields, etc. There has to be a praxis. There has to be a ritual orientation. Without that ritual orientation, if you only have a theory, then the idea, whatever it is, whatever sampradaya, it is not going to go ahead anyway. So Tantra was sort of a new idea of ritualism that came in. From it developed to a great amount of peak in Kashmir, where it was focused more on Shiva as the main deity. That was the primary idea. So we had texts and tremendous scholars and acharyas who were experts in tantric literature. And before going into the text, you have to understand that how does it derive its authority? So in any kind of any of the sampradaya, any of the schools within Hinduism, there is always, it has a way in which it describes itself, that why am I legitimate? That question comes up. So tomorrow you form a school, you form a sampradaya. Why should anybody take it seriously? Okay, that's the first question. Just because you say something doesn't mean that it is to be true. There are certain ways in which legitimacy of the path is determined. So the tantric legitimacy of the path comes from one basic simple idea that Shiva revealed a new path which is appropriate for people of Kali Yuga. This was the basic idea. So every whole bit of it comes. There is always, even today in the later tantric literature or in the earlier literature, you find that there is always, it is Shiva who is speaking to Parvati. Shiva is saying that this is the method, this is the way you worship, this is the deity you worship, things like that. So it is the words of Shiva that make it self-fulfilling. It's the word of Shiva that gives it the power that this is a valid method and this is how it is going to be. Then the question comes that why was the necessity for another path? So there you'll find that the oldest acharyas, and oldest means by the time when Avinavaguptacharya came in Kashmir, it was already, Tantra was already there. It was already full-fledged working, and there were a stream of powerful siddhas and acharyas who were working. He was the most famous of their lot, perhaps one of the most famous, because he was a polymath and he was a tremendous genius, both in Upasana as well as knowledge, etc. So they mentioned this, that as this age of Kali Yuga starts, there is a general degradation of human capacity, a general degradation of human competency, of the gunas. There is corruption all around. Because of this, the Vedic rituals which were there, and it describes at one place that the Vedic rituals are like earlier revelations. The Vedas are already... they have their own approach to the ritualism and how things are to be done. So they are saying those may not work at this time because there have been changes in the atmosphere. There have been changes in the capacity of people. Lifespan has reduced. There's another argument they bring in, which is that people are not able to take prana from the atmosphere. Prana is what sustains everything. So they take prana from their food. So which means that there is any corruption in the food that you're eating is going to affect your mind, your body, etc. So there is a limitation that is put by nature. due to which there is only some aspect of the rituals which you may be able to actualize, the older rituals, and a lot large part of it you can't do. So because of that, out of compassion for humanity, Shiva therefore says that, okay, I'm going to reveal another path which is suitable for people of this age of generally lower competency. Everybody is lower, has a lower competency according to that. And it is, its validity comes because it comes from Shiva's mouth. So that is why it is valid. This is how. Now, with this, the original idea was Shaivism, for example. Before we go into Tantra, let's talk a little bit about what you can call proto-Shaivism, which is the original Shaivism that was there. So Shaivism developed into two parallel streams at that time. One was what is called the Shaiva Siddhanta, and one was the non-Siddhantika Shaivism. Shaiva Siddhanta, which is popular right now in South India, Tamil Nadu specifically, was also there very prominently in Kashmir. And it followed a set of texts, a set of agamas, which considered basically, I mean, just, you know, distilling it, not going into the complexity of it, but Sadashiva is the main primary form who is to be worshipped. This was one of the points. And the other points they had was the method of worship, their philosophy, their the pramanas they used, and how they looked at the equation between Shiva and the soul and the validity of texts. It was entirely different from the Vedic system, but it had no great deviation from the Vedic social life. So that is very important. So basically means the Varna system that was followed in the Vedic life plus other things. They accepted all that. Only thing is, they said that this Shaivism does not take its authority from the Vedas. It takes from the Agamas, which is the Shaiva Siddhanta Agamas that came. And there were many great scholars and acharyas who propounded this path. And they followed, and the difference was that this was, the difference between lay Shaivism and this was that this is initiatory Shaivism. So this is very important. Initiatory means to get into the system, one has to take an initiation or a diksha. Only then you are part of the system. Without the diksha, you cannot be a part of this system. Along with it, there was another path that broadly, and these classifications, you know, what I'm talking about, say, Siddhantika Shaivism, non-Siddhantika Shaivism, etc. These are what scholars look at it today. It's not necessarily how they saw it at that time. So, you know, the acharyas, they used to, as it's usual, the acharya of the Siddhantika fold would consider that my theology, my system of upasana and the way I look at it is the one, is the right, perfect one. Whereas the acharya and the scholars and the practitioners of the non-Siddhantika system would consider, no, mine is the right one. So the difference was that the non-Siddhantika Shaivism considered Bhairava a rather aggressive form of Shiva, terrifying form of Shiva as the primary deity. So from him came the agamas and the, you know, streams of knowledge that emanated from Bhairava. And it is here that we see that there are introduction of certain practices which are more, which deviate from the original Vedic system, which was the, you know, followed in larger part of India. So this non-Siddhantika Shaivism, there are other classifications also. For example, I'm just mentioning this in case somebody is interested. So even in, there's the other classification that Shaivism also had two other paths, which is one was called the Atimarga and one was called the Mantra Marga. Atimarga was basically what evolved into Pashupats and all the other systems, etc. And Mantra Marga was, Atimarga was only specific to sannyasis. So people who have left home, etc. And in only in the pursuit of their spiritual progress, they would go into the Atimarga Shaivism. And then it evolved from there, various streams and various acharyas and all came in through Atimarga system. And there was the Mantra Marga. Mantra Marga was basically that, you know, you don't need to leave society, you can be in society. But this system involves that from one mantra sadhana, you go to another mantra sadhana. But remember, in all these systems, it was Shiva who is the primary deity. Okay, or forms of Shiva, some or the other form of Shiva. He is the main, he is the, you know, the aim of the path. He is what one has to realize. And it's interesting that they looked at what we commonly today understand moksha as a liberation from rebirth, etc. While it was also there, there was there was a different definition of what exactly constitutes a very high spiritual state. So there is one of the texts, old texts, which mentioned that when just like a spirit possesses a man, when Shiva possesses somebody, that itself is liberation. Okay. So basically what it is saying is that that human being is, you can call him divine, godlike or something. He's possessed entirely by Lord Shiva. So whatever action he does, it is not his action he's doing. It is Shiva who is doing through him. So that condition of being, to be like a deity, to be, you know, close to Shiva to that degree, that itself is a form of liberation. So now coming back to these two streams, it is from the Mantra Marara, which means the system that followed Mantra Upasana one after the other. That Mantra Marga system was used extensively in both the Shaiva Siddhanta as well as the non-Siddhantika Shaivism. Now, Shaiva Siddhanta itself went on to reach a great peak in India, at least till I think 11th, 12th century perhaps, and not just India, outside India also. So, at one point, their acharyas, their systems, their institutions were spread out across, not just in Kashmir, across India, whether it's Maharashtra, whether it's MP, whether it's Bengal. They had, they used to produce some of the most powerful Rajgurus. So their acharyas used to become the official initiator of the kings and the various rulers in different parts of India. Their rituals over time evolved into what is more public facing rituals in a temple, which means that how do you conduct the, so when we talk about that, you know, this temple is follows the Agamic methods of Upasana and these rituals are done regularly. Or today, for example, when you see the Kumbhabhishekam of a temple done in South India, etc., those all come from the Shaiva Siddhanta system. So their focus was very strongly evolved over time into rituals that were more public facing. So which, you know, average people can go to the temple and see. And regular conducting of those rituals to keep the temples energized, the deities, the vigrahas and all that. Whereas the non-Siddhantika system, as a, which considered Bhairava as the supreme deity, that became more of individualistic upasana. That was not so much concerned with the temple rituals. It did have temple rituals, but that became secondary. So here the system was more of that, how does one perform one's own, enhance one's own spiritual progress through this path. This system, in fact, one of the earliest forms of Shiva, Bhairava, who was worshipped in the non-Siddhantika system, was known as the Swachanda Bhairava, the autonomous form of Bhairava. And from there, it evolved slowly into what we today more commonly known as Kal Bhairava and the other Ashta Bhairavas and other forms, etc. Now, this system, which was Bhairava-centric, eventually, as years, centuries passed by, developed into what is known as the Shakta Tantra, worship of Shakti as the primary form of the deity. The initial conception was that Shakti is an emanation of Shiva. So there has to be. So eventually what they did was this, the Shakta Tantra, the Shakti component of Shiva worship was made exclusive. And it was considered as a higher and a more esoteric path than normal worship of Shiva. So this was one stream by around, say, 9th, 10th century itself. Worship of Shakti became prominent in the Tantric system, in the Shaiva Tantra. And therefore, it sort of evolved from there into, from that space, it evolved today into what we have as the current scenario in Tantric Upasana. And what normally, as if you speak to a layman, he would say that, you know, Tantra means worship of some of the other forms of the goddess, etc. Though it is important to note that Tantra was also, Tantra is a technique, basically a way of approaching a deity. Tantra was also there, Vaishnava Tantra was there, and other Tantras were also there. It is not entirely only Shakta, though in common perception, majority of the Tantric texts later on that were composed were entirely focused on some of the other form of the goddess. So it is from this point, from the Shaiva Tantra, that Shakta Tantra evolved around 9th, 10th century, and then it took a life of its own through evolution. At the same time, there was, I mentioned that in Eastern India, there used to be another stream of development of tantric literature, tantric practices, which perhaps, I mean, there is some debate on this among scholars, but most likely it is from the temple, around, in and around the temple of Kamakhya that it started. So this was one stream of tantra. So tantra itself is not one singular entity. There are various streams inside it, various systems and subdivisions, etc. So this was what today is known as Koula Tantra. The word Koula and the systems of Koula Tantra, it is here, these methods, when they became more popular in the 19th century and these texts and these systems came out in public, that is what created the perception among people, those who have not studied it properly, that perhaps Tantra is a divine path and things like that. And it is in these systems, in the Koula system, plus as well as the the Shakta Tantra that developed even from the non-Siddhantika system, that it deviated strongly in some places from the Vedic method of Upasana. So there was the introduction of what is known as the most controversial thing known as the Panchamakara, the five M's that are used in Tantric Upasana. So the basic idea was that the Tantric systems, their conception of ritual purity, their conception of what is acceptable in Upasana, what is not acceptable in Upasana, is entirely different. Now, before we go into this Panchamakara, it is important that we understand one of the key aspects of Tantra is initiation. Without initiation, one cannot, not even today, not then, not in the initial conception, neither is it today possible, that you cannot practice Tantra, Tantric Upasana without initiation. Specifically, when we are talking about Shakta Tantra, which is what the general perception of Tantra is, that worship of the Divine Mother. Initiation is absolutely mandatory. Initiation gives you the right. The Adhikara comes through initiation. So, this is a clear deviation, for example, from the Vedic system, where the practice of the Vedas comes through an Adhikara by birth. First level of Adhikara, which is that you have to be born in the certain Varna, the specific Varna, only then you may be able to do Veda Adhyayana. After that, you need to have the Upanayanam, this, and then you can, if you practice sufficiently, you may be able to do the Vedic rituals, Karmakanda, etc. In the Tantric system, the Adhikara, the system of deciding that who has the right to practice this method of worship, is not based on birth, it is based on initiation. Whoever has that initiation, Tantric initiation that is given, that individual accordingly will have the right to certain degree of rituals. And initiations are not just one. There is a series of initiations in Tantra. It starts off with one. After some time you practice, then the guru decides that whether you can do, whether you get the next level of initiation. After that, you are given some more practices, higher level of practices. So like this, this is how the system was. And not just was, it's even today it's practiced in that sense. So without that initiation, it Tantra has, there's no basis for, it's not about, there are many people who, you may find that suddenly they pick up a book and some mantra they pick up from there and then starting. That's not how it is to be done formally, if one is interested. And the second aspect is that Tantra has a classification of the all the various practices, the various mantras, etc., that are given. There's a basic classification of that which is done, which is that, for example, Shiva is considered to have five faces. So from each of these five faces together, there are 7 crore mantras that have come out of these. 7 crore mantras. These are the only mantras which can be practiced in this Kali Yuga. But which mantra can be done when? It is based on, again, there are further classifications, which means there are certain mantras which are considered that they have come from Shiva's upper face, which is the Uddhamnaya. These are Amnyas, these are 4 directions. 5 faces are there, 4 horizontal faces and 1 vertically upwards. So each of them are faces that also transmit a certain mantra. When transmitting a mantra, it is like transmitting a Vidya. Along with the mantra, there is a knowledge system that is passing through that. Okay. So these were called the directional transmission systems. The term they used was Amnyas. Even today we use this term. So depending on what kind of initiation an individual has, and where he's, what level he has reached, etc. So accordingly, the guru and the sampradaya to which he is linked will decide which kind of mantra he can do. So the deity may be one, for example, in tantra. But each of the amnayas will have different mantras of the deity. So there may be, a single deity may have, say, 8 different mantras, 10 different mantras, and each of the mantras, by changing the mantras a little bit, the formation, the kind of energy of the deity that you're trying to tap into is also slightly different. So, which means a mantra that comes from the upper face of Shiva should not ideally be chanted for somebody who has just entered into the tantric path. So these kind of various rules, etc., are there. Now, practically, with time, as tantra evolved, in practice, it went into 2 broad schools of tantra, which is prevalent today. One is the, in south, you'll have, not just south, but centered around south, let's say, we have the Sri Kula, and in north, and especially eastern India, you have what is called the Kali Kula. Kali Kula is basically, Kali is the primary deity. When you say Kali Kula, it's not, or Sri Kula, it's not just one deity. It's Kali is the primary, and there will be auxiliary other forms which have to be worshipped in the path as governed by the system, basically. So, in both of the systems, there is, as I mentioned, there is the system of initiation. Both of them will have it. So, anybody who wants to practice tantra has to go through a process of initiation. And after initiation, the guru or the tradition will give him certain practices. Now, what exactly do these practices constitute for? First, at the basic level, you'll have what is known as the simple practice of the mantra sadhana, which is guru will give you a certain mantra and you have to keep practicing that. And there are certain counts, let us put it this way, there are certain injunctions for each sadhana that the guru will tell you. Say you're doing a specific mantra, and that mantra has to be chanted x lakh number of times within this period of time, etc. So you keep doing that. This is, you do it as many times as the guru tells you, and by virtue of those practice, it causes certain changes in your consciousness. Once that change happens, then the guru may decide that, okay, let's go to the next stage of sadhana. Okay, and they may give you some other practice. Now, here another important concept has to be understood. The tantra also believes there is a certain system of acharas or modes of conduct that is important for the upasaka. So, this is the progression, basically. At least in some of the tantric texts, it mentions the progression, which means first, it says that the lowest of the acharyas is the Vedacharya, which what it means basically is that the general uninitiated person who is within the Hindu fold, for example, doing his whatever sandhya upasana and other things that he is doing. So he is practicing that thing, and that also is causing some changes in him. Beyond that, he goes into what is Vaishnavachara, Shaivachara, and all those other systems. So these are also initiatory systems. Beyond that, it comes to proper tantra starts, what is called as the Dakshinachara. Dakshinachara system is where you have the tantric system starts from there. Certain rules of mantra sadhana, where important aspect, the most fundamental aspect of tantric upasana is the mantra sadhana. Revolving around it, there will be auxiliary things. For example, after the mantra upasana is finished, one has to do homas, one may have to do tarpana, one may have to do marjana, one may have to do Abhishekam, one may have to do feed people. All these are part of the mantra upasana. Feeding is also important. And there are, guidelines mentioned that, specifics are very important in tantra. For example, if a tantric upasana says that you have to do a mantra 1,000 times, so you have to do it 1,000. If you do one less, 999, it won't work. If you do one more, it won't work. So it's like that. Everything is very clearly defined and specific. This progression of acharyas is important because the idea was that as the mantra sadhana works inside an upasaka, it causes certain changes in his mind, in his consciousness, and that change reflects in the way he looks at society, he looks at things around him. So as he becomes more attuned to certain higher realities of the path, he is allowed to experience, not just experience, but use different kind of ingredients for different deities. Here, the important aspect is after Dakshinachara, what comes in some texts, what is known as the Vamachara. Vamachara is where you have things like alcohol, meat, fish, etc. is offered to the deities. Not all deities, some deities. And it is important to understand that this is not done in the sense of, consumption. No. The idea is that there is a huge ritualistic purification process before this is done. It's not randomly just, you go and buy something and offer them. And only someone who has the adhikara for it should be doing it. It is not, again, nothing in Tantra is random and I just, wake up one morning and I feel I want to do this as an yotai. Everything has to be systematic in a way. Once somebody crosses a certain threshold and is given the the adhikara by the guru through the proper initiation, he will be able to use those things. All of these are useful. The idea was that one has to be, these are in normal understanding, we see that whether it's meat or whether it's fish or whether it's alcohol, these things are tamasic and rajasic ingredients. They're not sattvic. But the idea is that through upasana, one must be able to handle all the kinds of energies. So unlike in certain other paths in Hinduism, which is focused entirely on sattva, here the idea is that the deity or the energy that you're worshipping must be able to manifest through all the gunas. And he is the greatest of the upasaka, the beyond, the highest, considered to be the highest, who can handle that energy through any of the gunas. He is not fixated that I only want the sattvic one and I will not go towards the tamasic. Even within tamas, you should be able to find out the state which is beyond the three gunas. Of course, that's the theory. There are many caveats in the path, and goes without saying that anybody who is not who doesn't have the adhikara for this, who hasn't had sufficient practice, if he directly goes into entering these kind of ritual worship system, will cause more damage to himself than good. So after Vamachara, there is the next stage that comes is known as the Virachara, and these things, again, as I said, all of them have their, there is a Diksha Krama. Once that Diksha is given by the Guru, only then the person is able to do those sadhanas. Here, there are worship of certain forms of the deity which involve liminal spaces, and that is very important in Tantra. Liminal spaces like cremation grounds or in, a deserted area or near a river where there's nobody or on a hill. So the idea is the upasaka slowly gets control over fear. Fear is a natural human element in everybody that is there. So you have to understand that each of these systems slowly develop, that step by step, correctly performed, eventually one is overcoming the various bondages that one has inside, the ashtapashas. There are 8 pashas that are there in a human being, it's considered. Each of them is being overcome one by one through the practice. And then as he or she overcomes this practice, he or she can go higher to the next stage like this. And finally, at the highest of the stages, was considered as Kolachara. Kolachara is basically where there are involved. This is the system where there is involvement of what is known as Bhairavi Upasanas and other things, where there is a ritualized sexual component that comes in the form of sadhana. Problem that has happened today in a lot of places because of various half-baked people writing about Tantra and this and that, etc. So they have removed the whole system and picked up one or two things from the top, which is not to be practiced until one reaches the highest stage. And then they have created their, we are doing Tantra and this and that. This is absolute, complete nonsense. This is not how it is to be done at all. In fact, the texts tell you, the Kulandava Tantra has a very beautiful passage where Shiva is saying that Kolachara is the highest of the Tantric Acharas. But for somebody who is unfit, if he jumps into it, so if he goes directly into these kind of heterodox practices without creating a sufficient base, he will not only fall, the Vidya will not only leave him, but he will be left in a worse condition than he has started. So basically, before even entering the path, whatever his spiritual condition was, he will enter into a much lower condition if he does not have the adhikara and he just starts copying things from here and there. So that And this Adhikara Tantra further mentions may not come in one lifetime. So this whole path is not to be traversed in one lifetime alone. It's very much possible that somebody may spend the whole life practicing one of the acharyas of Tantra, one of the systems of tantric practice, and his consciousness evolves to a certain stage. In next life, he goes into nature, creates the system for him, nature creates the opportunity for him so that he can practice the other higher stages of sadhana. Now, another important point to be mentioned is and here there is a difference in the Sri Kula and the Kali Kula. Sri Kula is basically revolves around Lalita, Tripura, Sundari and various forms, associated forms of the deity. There is, during medieval era, there was a development where a lot of people who were in mainstream Vedic sampradayas, they also started entering into the tantric fold for whatever reason. I believe, which is good in a way, because that kind of gave a lot of legitimacy to Tantra. And plus, there were some, at least a few of the practitioners who were very high caliber. There's no doubt about that. But in order that they could maintain in order that there was there's no conflict between the Vedic lifestyle and the heterodox practices in Tantra. So they stuck to only the Dakshinachara method of Tantra, which means that without using any of the five makaras as it is. So there was no use of alcohol, no use of meat or fish or other things, etc. Their practice evolved entirely around what you may call the straight path of Tantra, which is had no conflict with the normal societal ways. So that gave an opportunity. A lot of people who are, say, vegetarians, they would enter into the path, or maybe there were a lot of, they would enter into the path and they would be able to follow the rituals of Tantra without violating any of their core ideas or their lifestyles or things like that. So that over time evolved into a fixed system in itself within the larger, whole of Tantra, which is called the Dakshinamargi, Dakshinachara Tantra, where instead of these five. But remember, the interesting thing is, though there was no use of this panchamakara in them, there was no use of meat, there was no use of alcohol, these things, they did use something known as the anukalpa. So they cannot cancel these things. They cannot say that, oh, we don't want any of these five things to be used at all. Because the shastras are very clear. Shiva is mentioning this in the tantras, that these things are necessary at a certain stage of worship of certain forms of the deity. It's very important that who is the form to whom these are being offered. So it cannot be to any form of the deity. There is a specific form that has the ability to appreciate and consume these offerings, and in turn provide you with a positive result for your development. So those forms, if you worship, you will need those things. But what was done is, there are substitutes for these, each of these. So instead of meat, there is a vegetarian alternative that is specific, very specific, that itself has to be used. Instead of fish, there is a vegetarian alternative. That specific substitute has to be used. Instead of alcohol, there will be a certain alternative that is not non-alcoholic. But again, it has to be very specific. It cannot be any, random thing I feel like using. No. Those specific ingredients have to be used. The mantras remain the same. There is a, and these, by the way, if you see an actual tantric upasana, very few people, most average people have hardly ever seen a proper tantric sadhana, to be honest. Even before the actual sadhana starts, at least an hour or maybe 1.5 to 2 hours goes in the purification of the rituals, purification of the ingredients, purification of the body, purification of the asana that you're sitting. So binding the direction so that there are no interfering energies from anywhere, etc. So all these things, that is just the preparation even before the actual sadhana starts. So all these systems, these mantras, this etc., which was used in the the methods in those tantric schools which did not use an anukalpa or a substitute. Anukalpa is a substitute, which means that they directly used meat when meat has to be offered. They used fish when fish has to be offered. They used alcohol, and alcohol has to be offered. And the Dakshinamargi tantric paths, which used anukalpas, largely, by and large, the complexity of the ritual was the same, except that the ingredient was changed to something specific from the vegetarian fold, something specific that does not violate with the Vedic lifestyle, but it has some property of that element. So this was the sort of innovation that was done. Property of the element means, suppose instead of one of the very popular ideas that is used in certain sampradayas. Instead of meat, instead of one of the makaras, they will use ginger in specific quantity. But if it is ginger, suppose it's ginger or something else, it has to be that only. You cannot randomly pick any vegetable and say that, oh, today I'm assuming that this, serves as a substitute for that particular ingredient. No. So in everything, the tantras are very, very specific. What can be used, what cannot be used, how much to be used. This technique is the thing that is most vital in tantric upasana. And it can never, never be learned by books. Unless you are connected to a sampradaya and there is a good qualified guru who teaches you that how this is to be done. Now, the next thing beyond the panchamakara, there are, and also to mention the Kalikula sampradayas, those which consider Kali as the primary deity, normally 9 out of 10 times when they perform these practices, and they're very vital in fact, practices, they do use the ingredients as it is. They do not use anukalpas normally. Whereas in Sri Kula, there are a lot of sampradayas which do use the anukalpas instead of actually using the main ingredient. After this, the next achara that comes into play is the Veera achara, which is that Veera is basically a hero. So the word Veera has to be understood in the sense that Tantra defines that all men are eventually of three basic qualities. One is the first nature of large amount of men are known as the Pashus, or the animals who are bound by their own deficiencies, the pashas, the chains that bind the consciousness. Beyond that, there is the Veera, and beyond that, there is the Divya, the divine. So, for a pashu, when a person is bound by the various rules and his various deficiencies, weaknesses that he has inside, there are many restrictions on what he can practice and what he cannot practice. Whereas when a person enters into the stage of the Veera, then that practices, there are heterodox, that is where the various heterodox ideas come into his practice, so that it prepares him for the next stage. Whereas someone who has reached the stage of the Divya, the divine, for him there are actually basically sort of very little rules or no rules. Whatever he feels, he thinks, he wants to do, is allowed to do, because he has already reached a stage where he is sort of in communion with the deity. Large section, 90% of the tantric literature is aimed at how the practice has to be done for the second stage, for the people of the second category, which is the Veeras. Now, Veerachara is a practice which is very much prominent in the Kali Kula, more so than in the Sri Kula. In Veerachara, one of the important aspects is where the upasana happens in cremation grounds. This again has various rules and regulations, of course, and the guru himself will tell you. But the guru himself teaches the aspirant that what needs to be done. But this is where the use of elements, for example, not just the cremation ground. In fact, there is a specific stage in the sadhana where some schools, they may even keep a skull from a dead body for certain practices. This is where all this, these practices were actually evolved from as I was mentioning at the beginning, the Shaiva practices, the Shaiva tantric practices had all these systems. So from there, we have come down, we have evolved today that there are, after a certain stage of sadhana, these things come into play. But again, there are various rules and regulations guiding them. It's not random and it cannot be done by everybody. So this is how eventually, finally, after following all these technicalities and things like that, the aim of the tantric upasana is that eventually the practitioner, whether it's male or female, etc. Unlike again the Vedic path, female woman can very easily follow the tantric system and keep doing sadhana and go higher up. That's there. The final aim is that he or she should be in communion with the deity. That is what is practically the final goal. In fact, many of the tantric texts spend very little time in discussing philosophy. There is one 15th century tantric text written in Kamakhya, which mentions there's a very interesting conversation with Shiva and Parvati going on. Parvati is asking that there are the six darshanas in mainstream Hinduism, you know, which of these is the correct one? And Shiva says that I created those six darshanas so that people can keep arguing. Then he says that the aim of the Upasaka is that let him first attain to the state where his mind is entirely transformed, and then let him see that what is the reality, and then let him decide that which of these darshanas is suitable for him. So just a two-line thing, but it kind of captures how the tantric texts have looked at philosophy as a whole. So there will be maybe one or two lines in the text which will mention basic philosophy. So aim is that, you know, you need to reach the feet of the Divine Mother, you need to reach a very high state of oneness with the deity, etc. Beyond that, it will not go too much into the philosophy. It will go jump straight into there will be a chapter on how diksha is to be done, then how the mantras are, what rules and regulations that we followed for this particular mantric practice, etc. So in this sense, if you read a tantra, it is quite different from the way a Purana is written. Purana, you will have the Puranic texts start, you know, a discussion of the cosmology and other aspects, you know, when exactly, what happened initially, how life came into being, how the deities came, and how there were, some Puranas will go into descriptions of the kings, the great, you know, ancient rishis and kings and all that. Tantra, you'll never find all that. You'll have perhaps a chapter one where and it's mostly Shiva and Parvati, or Bhairava and Bhairavi discussing tantras, and it's mostly Parvati or Bhairavi who is asking this question of Bhairava, and Bhairava is answering the question. So Shiva and Bhairava is considered as the guru, the ultimate guru in the tantric path. It is his words that make tantra a valid path. So this, as I mentioned, is the, you know, the crux of the pramana that tantra uses, that why it is a valid path, because Shiva has said it is so, and because Shiva has said, therefore it is so, like this. So then it spends very little time with the philosophy. It spends a lot of time with the actual method of sadhana, what needs to be done. So there's a popular misconception, and especially this misconception comes from many Westerners. You'll see that, at least that's what I have found, many Western scholars are, in the last one century, there have been a lot of people with great amount of curiosity about the tantric practices and texts and all that. And the moment they find something like this, okay, the tantric system does not follow the Varna system exactly as it is in the Vedic lifestyle, etc. So they came to the conclusion that therefore the tantras were like some kind of a revolt against mainstream Hinduism. That is completely wrong, in my opinion. These things come in because you will never really understand tantra until you practice it. From outside, you will only get an idea, and that idea is most likely going to be wrong. Either you will find that, you know, when somebody hears this Panchamakara and other things, either they will think that this is some kind of debauched divine practice, it's very bad, or somebody will think that, okay, it's a license to do what you want. Both of them are wrong. There is a specific method behind all this. Until you can figure out or understand the method, and you will not understand without the practice of the system. So it is true, for example, that tantras did deviate a lot from the Vedic system, still deviates a lot. It has its own methodology, but it is not because it is revolting against anything. It says, for example, in the basic mantra sadhana paddhati that is mentioned, you start off with doing the practices of, you know, whatever mantra sadhana you do, etc. At the end of it, there are various steps that has to be done. At the end, the last step that you need to do is also feed people. And there it mentions that you have to feed among various, you know, categories of people that you can feed. One of the important things it mentions is you have to feed Brahmins. So if it was even a kind of a system that was more like, you know, a revolt against the standard prevalent system, it would have not given an injunction that your mantra upasana becomes complete when you feed Brahmins. But the reason perhaps is that during the time when the texts were written, the idea was that you have to feed somebody who is also an upasaka, who is into the system, who is doing some spiritual practice. And by and large, in that era when the texts were written, the majority of spiritual practice was done by the Brahmin community. There's no denying this fact. So the idea was your sadhana becomes complete when you are feeding an upasaka, and this is a much greater chance that if you feed a you feed a Brahmin that he will be an Upasaka and yours, whatever sadhana you're doing will succeed. So this is how this system was designed, looking at the practicality of the situation at that time, that this is how, you know, these are the reality of the things. And therefore, if I follow this methodology, I have the greatest chance of succeeding in the mantra sadhana. So apart from this, in actual practice of tantra, there are once, apart from the mantras, there is a use of something called, we use, yeah, each of the deities have, and this is actually a very complicated topic, but beyond the mantra, there is also called the yantras of each deity. Yantra is basically a mystical diagram which connects, which has the information coded into it of the deity. And when we say a mantra sadhana, it is important to understand that just like there is the vigraha, the murti of a deity, you go into a temple and see, the mantra itself is the body of the deity. So the mantra itself is like the deity. So there is no difference between a mantra and the deity. So when a mantra is received by an initiate after initiation, he has to guard the mantra very specifically so that nobody else gets to know it. He has to rever and respect the mantra. He has to follow the rules. It is via this, via the practice of the mantra, that you are actually connecting to the consciousness of the deity for a certain brief period of time, if your practice is going well. So there is this beautiful injunction. It says that the guru is the father of the mantra, because from the guru the mantra comes. And the mantra is the father of the deity, which means by the practice of the mantra, you are actually able to connect to the deity. Without the mantra, you believe that there is a deity, but you have not experienced the deity. You don't know what the deity is. You have certain ideas and conceptions that have been given to you through books, through people, etc. Okay, this exists, that exists, fine. But only when you are entering into the deeper states of mantra sadhana, that you will know that, okay, there is indeed a deity. And each deity, and not just one deity, each deity will have different forms. Each of these forms have a specific connection to a specific mantra. So this understanding is crucial, and it develops over time as one keeps going into the tantric practices.
Question is, what is possession or avesh as per tantra? How to make sense of it?
Okay. Possession by itself, when we talk of possession, we need to first get away from the Western perspective of possession completely. So Western, or let's put it, the Christian perspective of possession is that it is a very bad thing. You get possessed by spirits, ghosts, this, that, and therefore it's a very negative kind of state. Then you need to get out of that possession of things like that. This is the basic Western idea, and which has been reinstated over and over through films and books and this and that popular conception. The tantric systems do not look at possession that way. Possession means basically at any given point, say very simply speaking, today you, maybe 10, 15 years ago, we did not have the internet. Today, everybody needs a mobile phone all the time. If you're doing nothing, you need to just surf the net and see what is going on. So in a way, it is something. This entity called the internet, which is an idea perhaps, has taken some possession of you. So it is guiding your life in some way or the other, whether you like it or not. Without the internet, you will not survive. You'll need, whether you have to order food or you have to book a cab or do anything. So possession is anything that grasps your consciousness to a certain degree and then makes you behave in a certain way depending on the nature of that entity. Now, this is just a very simplified definition of possession. Possession can be good, possession can be bad. There are various things that can possess an entity, an individual. There are possessions which lead to a debilitation of the mental and physical health, leading to death. These are, let's classify them as negative possession. These are the things which is considered, say, possession by a spirit or something lower than that and things like that. Whereas the term that is more often used, the avesham that is used, is often something that happens when a deity possesses the individual. The possession by a deity is entirely different from the possession by a lower entity. when a deity possesses an individual for a certain period of time, and depending on how clear the possession is, there are categories of this, because remember that a deity does not easily come into a human being or into an environment. I mean, when you're worshipping anything, you are invoking, the first step is that you're doing a prana pratishthapana, you're invoking the deity. But before you invoke the deity, you have to purify the elements, you have to know that where exactly are you invoking the deity. The deity is too powerful, too subtle, therefore it is not going to come into anything and everything. There are certain energies, certain things in which a deity may enter, and certain gross elements where he or she, the deity, may not want to enter, may not even come inside. To invoke a deity inside, either by will or by an accident, sometimes avesham can happen even by accident, there has to be a certain degree of purity inside the individual. For the period of time the avesham happens for that individual of a deity, of a higher power, he or she may start manifesting certain abilities which are not ordinarily human manifestations. There may be a sudden increase in the intuitive capacity of the individual. He may be able to say or see things which may seem remarkable. Plus, there will also be, in cases that I have seen, there may also be instances where that individual may get cured himself or cure somebody else of a disease that they have. I mean, these are things which, if you watch them actually happening, you will have, these are not question of argument. I'm not talking that whether it happens or not. That it happens is a fact, just like gravity is a fact. You have to see that and you will see for yourself. Phir, kaise ye cheez ho raha hai? Why is it happening this way? Why is it happening that way? What is the theory behind it? That you can develop on your own as you think about it. But if an avesham, if a possession by a higher deity happens in an individual for the period of time, he or she will start in that phase manifesting certain qualities which are beyond human, suprahuman, let's call it, beyond the normal faculties of human beings. And in fact, in a way, the whole of sadhana that you do of a deity, of the, say you are doing worshipping a goddess, your aim is that eventually you reach a stage of the sadhana, your purity comes to that stage that as and when you need, the deity actually connects to your mind connects to the deity, there's a certain degree of possession of the deity that happens in your mind, and the deity governs your actions and tells you what needs to be done, what needs to not, did not be done. From your human perspective, if you try to do a thing, you'll make mistakes, you'll guess, your mind is, the human mind is not strong enough to come to the right conclusion about everything. I mean, we use logic, which is a very wonderful tool, and very important tool, but there is a field of the mind that is beyond logic. So the deity can bring in that field, and during the time when the possession with the avesham happens, that individual may manifest certain extraordinary abilities and powers at a very higher state, even higher than that, what we technically or ordinarily call the mahasiddhas. They may be in a state where they are having the avesham of the deity. It's not even an avesham. The deity is inside them 24/7, all the time. In that case, that is that individual. Suppose you were to meet an individual like that, which is very unlikely, but I'm just saying, suppose somebody is lucky enough, you have some punya from past life that you meet an individual of that caliber, then you are basically interacting with the deity. You're not, there's no human being there, it's just the body, but the consciousness is entirely of the deity. And you will see tremendous things around such individuals. It's unbelievable. It's like all your basic conceptions of life will take a 180 degree turn. If you were ever by chance, and chance only because it requires great amount of luck to even come across an individual like that. It's not easy. It's not based on how much sadhana you have done. Something has to come from your past life only then. If you meet an individual like that, your conceptions, your ideas, your formulas that you have set in your mind, all will get smashed. So avesham or possession is not at all a bad thing in the Indian, let's not use the word possession because it carries a baggage from the, you know, that possession ho gaya, it's very bad and all that spirits, not like that. As I mentioned, there is an old text which says that liberation is when Shiva possesses an individual, just like a ghost can possess an individual. When Shiva himself enters into an individual and decides that I am going to stay in the man's or woman's consciousness all the time, that is liberation. You have all the powers of Shiva, you are free. Power though is only comes as a secondary aspect of it. The primary aspect is there is a sense of freedom that you simply cannot experience as a human being. Humans at every stage try certain things. For example, you have a plan that I want to do this, So you make an effort for that. There's a plan, there's an action, and then there is failure. Failure will lead to frustration. When a deity enters and does a thing from an individual, the chances of failure, the chances of obstruction to that action is minimal. So that is how possession is to be looked at in the, you know, tantric perspective or even Indic perspective, let's put it this way.
Thank you, Rajashriji, for this wonderful, wonderful explanation. I go to the next question now. The next question is also by a student from Indus University, and they are asking, what is black magic and how is it associated with Tantra?
So, black magic is again basic. So, there is in Tantra, there is something known as the Abhichara Kriyas. Abhichara means is what you call black magic. Abhichara means basically application of rituals to cause certain negative effects. So there are six basic kinds of kriyas that can be done in Tantra. One is that there is Shanti Karma, you can create peace in the environment. Okay, then there is Vidveshana, you can create disturbance. Suppose there are two people and you want to create a fight between them, you can, not just 200 people, it can be done. Then there is Uchatana. Uchatana, if you do on somebody, say someone staying in a particular place for 10 years, if an Uchatana prayog is done, he'll just get up and run. I mean, I remember this very interesting incident. Me and a friend of mine, we had gone to Kashi. This was perhaps 2006 or something like that.
Please hold the mic up.
Yeah, can you hear it?
Yeah.
Okay. This was many, many years ago, 2006. Me and a friend, we had gone to Kashi and for certain practices and all that. I remember there was one gentleman, a very senior gentleman, sitting and doing some sadhana, and my friend asked him this question: what exactly is Uchatana? This is one of the kriyas in Tantra that is done. So this man starts, he looks at him and starts abusing him. Abusing means full raw abuses in Hindi, okay, this, that, etc. So my friend and me, we both got a little shocked. What happened? So my friend immediately got up from his seat, and then the man says, this is Uchatana. You were sitting down, you had to get up. A shock comes into your consciousness, you don't know what to do, you have to immediately get up and move from there. That exactly is Uchatana. This can be amplified through rituals, and it can be done on not just one, multiple people. Then there is, of course, Vashikarana, Sammohana, which is that attracting somebody. And then there is finally something called Marana. Why were these rituals given? These rituals were given to be used under specific conditions. So Tantra is not making any moral judgment. It is saying that suppose Tantra did not exist at a time, let's go back in history, when there is no tantric system in place. Do you think people will not fight with each other? Do you think you will not have enemies? Do you think there will not be any disturbances, somebody, you know, trying to harm you? Or not just you. For example, you live in a place when there are hundreds of you, and there is somebody trying to invade that country or something like that. So the point is, these things are already there in the human consciousness, both the good and the bad. Tantra is saying that you want a specific result, I'll give you a technique that will amplify the result. That's about it. I'm not making a moral judgment. This is right and this is wrong. Moral judgment is not required, because if you misuse it, you will have a karmic repercussion. That is for sure. There's no doubt about it. So what is popularly known as black magic is basically nothing but a tantric prayog in the negative sense. But again, you have to understand this negative, positive, etc. is dependent on various factors. Various factors means like, for example, lightning. Lightning, if it falls on your head, you're finished. At the same time, if you can harness electricity, you can light a bulb at night and you can use it for various things. So the idea is that there is a power, there are various aspects of this power, and how do you channelize this power, whether you want it for something positive, whether you want it for negative, which depends on the circumstance that it is being used. So accordingly, generally what people consider as black magic is nothing but use of one of these or more aspects to cause harm to somebody.
Okay, thank you Rajesh for this wonderful explanation. Now I go to the questions from the audience, the general public, that is, there are so many people who are watching us live.
Okay.
One question is from Nikhil Thakur. He's asking a little about Shabar mantras. There are some Shabar mantras which can be practiced without a guru, he's asking. And then he has written some mantra also here, which I am not properly pronounce the mantras. He's saying, is it such a Shabar mantra allowed to be practiced by the guru-less, I mean, without the guru? That's what he's asking.
So, Shabar is a system of mantra sadhana that came in at least by the time of the Nath yogis, which is specifically Matsyendranath and Gorakshanath. They started the main. There is no so unlike formal what you call the formal tantric systems, Shabar systems are use mantras that are non-Sanskrit. So it could be in Hindi, it could be in, I've seen mantras in Bengali, I've seen in Hindi and other languages. Do they work? Yeah, they work very well. There's no doubt about that, the efficacy of Shabar mantras. But what I have seen is that for a Shabar mantra to work, you cannot pick it up from a book and just start doing. It will not give you the results. They work very fast. They work very fast, provided you get it from somebody who has already activated that mantra. That is the key to the whole Shabar mantra. So therefore, majority of the Shabar mantras, in fact, which are, and there are millions and millions of them, quite often they will have some or the other phrase in between. Not all, but at least say 70% of them will have a phrase in between that, that you know, Meri Bhakti, Guru Ki Shakti, aise karke, something like that in Hindi. See, your faith, the belief in this, the way this Shabar thing works is that you must have absolute faith on at least somebody, maybe who is giving you the mantra or something, that this individual is giving me, he's a terrific, maybe your guru or maybe something like that, etc. Somebody who is higher than you, who has activated it. So, because it is coming from his work, his mouth, therefore it is already authorized and it is going to work. It requires exceptional amount of faith. It works very fast. It works faster than Sanskrit mantras, Shabar mantra. But only catch is that you have to get it from somebody who has activated that specific mantra. Otherwise, if you just randomly pick up and start doing, if your concentration level is very good, you may get about, say, 10 to 20% of the intended result, not more than that. I mean, that's what I've seen till now.
The second question is from Raghav. How to find a guru in today's world who can initiate an individual into tantra?
This is the most difficult to answer, to be honest. Because there are all sorts of gurus today, and to be very honest, for every one genuine individual, there are 4 or 5 who are different degrees of either half lunatics or half frauds. And I've seen various things anyway. So the simplest, in my opinion, before either if you're clear, for example, if you want Dakshinachara tantric systems and all that, you know, you are interested to practice tantra, but you don't have you're not inclined to go into Vamachara and all that. So there are some traditional tantric sampradayas in South. You might want to go and talk to them and ask them that, you know, I am interested. Point is that spend at least, don't jump into a guru right on day one. We have various people read spiritual books and have this very high, very romantic idea that there is one great guru who is coming from the Himalayas or something like that, and he'll just initiate you and sab ho jayega. Aisa nahi hota hai ekdam. You have to work hard to get a guru also. So go ahead. Never lose your common sense. Meet people, meet sampradayas. Find out where are the tantric sampradayas. There are a lot of them. Whether it's Kashi, whether it's Bengal, whether it's with the Shabar sampradayas are there in North India, a lot of them. There are tantric sampradayas in South India, whether it's Srikula you like, whether it's Kalikula you like. You go, you meet, you talk to the individuals, but don't be in a hurry to take an initiation. Meanwhile, start doing some practice which can be done without initiation. And this is important here. While many of the mantras are not to be done without an initiation, there are some practices which can be done, especially related to stotras or, that relate to the names of the deity. So here is the thing, names of a deity, for the Namavalis or the Ashtottara Namas and all that, or the Shastra Namas of a deity, are open to anybody for doing. But basic thing you have to check is whether the deity gels with you. So somebody who is extremely soft-natured, if you give him or her a mantra or a Namavali of a deity who is extremely aggressive, say Namavali of Rakta Chamunda or something like that, it's going to completely cause disturbance in that system. So you have to understand what is your nature, what is that you like. Start with a Namavali and spend time in sadhana. If you do 5 minutes, 10 minutes of sadhana and then you believe that you will be able to progress spiritually, then you are living in a fool's paradise. You have to spend 24 hours a day, at least an hour has to be given for. Don't do 10 different things. Do one thing, but choose it wisely and believe in it. Spend it at least a year or so. Meanwhile, keep meeting gurus, meeting sampradayas. And I believe if these two things are done, you will eventually find somebody who will at least guide you to some degree. And it's important that to mention here that Tantra does not always specify that you have to have one guru. In fact, one of the Tantric texts even mentioned that it is very much, and not just mentions, this is evidenced from the history of great Tantric practitioners. There have been many people who have had multiple gurus. It's not a problematic thing. As your consciousness develops, as your stage develops, depending on your Purva Punya and other, suppose from one guru you may learn a few things, then you reach a higher state. Suppose you are a very excellent practitioner. Some you might find another guru to teach you one more vidya. So things like that. And there may be people who may have just one guru also. So do some practice. Keep your common sense with you and go about meeting people. Spend at least a year, actually go and meet them. And then you will be guided where exactly is best suitable for you, depending on the state of your consciousness. The practice is important because if you don't do the practice, your consciousness is not changing. If it is not changing, if there are a lot of disturbances inside you, you will only attract a guru according to that state. You are never going to. If you are in class 1, you will never get a guru who is at a PhD level.
How Tantra Sadhana is different in Buddhism as compared to Hinduism?
This is very difficult question to answer briefly. So, Bodha Tantra developed, they do a lot of practices. Some of the practices are perhaps more intense than Hindu Tantra. And mind you, my understanding of Bodha Tantra is only from as an outsider. I'm not a practitioner. Some idea I have. Let's put it this way. The majority of the Bodha Tantra was very highly focused on what we call the Vamachara practices. That was taken to Vamachara and Kolachara was taken to a very high degree. And they did attain an exceptional amount of proficiency in certain esoteric aspects of Tantra. But this happened only at a later date once they shifted wholesale to Tibet after, you know, sort of Buddhism and after the destruction of Nalanda and other places in India. After the invasions, etc., once they shifted to Tibet, perhaps in that atmosphere, certain practices were more suitable. But other than that, at the fundamental level of practice, it's not entirely different from us. Philosophical level, there is a difference because they look at all the deities finally. They use they worship the deities, no doubt, but their philosophical system is the final aim is finally you have to enter into the state of the shunya, which is the nothingness or the, you know, the nihilistic super consciousness state or something like that. And the deities are at the most fundamental level, they are also part of the shunya, which means they have no existence. But in the world of duality, they have an existence. So you are using the deities. The deities are helping you so that eventually you can enter into that state of mind. This is their conception. Whereas the Hindu Tantras are very much linked to the Hindu deities, the Hindu worldview, which is very important. So remember this thing, whereas that's what I tell people, if somebody in this age, there are people who believe that, you know, whether Tantra can be called Hindu or not, Tantra is 100% Hindu, though it may not entirely, not all of it may take Vedas as the authority. It doesn't make it less Hindu because the deities are the same. Remember, Shiva can be worshipped through the very high Vedic, through the Vedic hymns, just as he can be worshipped through the path of the Aghoris and the Kapalikas. It's the same deity. The path is different. So, at no point is Tantra negating any of the deities, not only Hindu, I'm talking about Hindu Tantra, but they completely absorb the Hindu worldview and they are keen on following certain of the basic Hindu ideas. For example, we know that mainstream Hinduism, Gohatya is a great sin. Tantra has also mentioned exactly the same thing. There's no difference in there. That, you know, Gohatya is one of the, I was just reading Rudra Yamala Tantra a few days ago. is as great a sin as murdering somebody. It mentions that. So these certain basic ideas that have completely, the broad outlook is entirely Hindu. It changes the rules for sadhana. It changes, disregards the rules of varna and other things because it says that it doesn't work when it comes to the field of sadhana. So that's what the tantric is.
Okay. The next is from Ram Valmiki. He's asking, can you please elaborate the importance of being aware of tithis in sadhana?
Tithis are very, very useful in sadhana. In fact, tithis are, it's a bit like on specific days and specific, tithis, how does the tithi form? Through the angular, through the angle between the sun and the moon. That is how a tithi comes in. So, knowing the tithi is immensely vital right from the first step of the sadhana, because when you are doing a sankalpa for the sadhana, and it's important that you, once you reach a little bit higher step, you need to do this sankalpa. Sankalpa means you are mentioning clearly that this is what I will, this is my will, this is what I want to do for XYZ thing. This sankalpa is what starts your sadhana. So there you have to mention the tithi. Plus, there are different tithis on which different deities, the energies of different deities are more easier to access. So, based on this tithis, we have sort of the whole sadhana system is designed based on that. So, knowledge of tithis is very, very vital. And even not only that, there are certain, at the higher levels of tantric sadhana which comes in, which is known as the prayoga. Prayoga is application of the vidya that you learn. Tithi becomes even more important because there are certain calculations through which there's a system known as where exactly Shiva, Lord Shiva is at a given date, at a given time specifically. This, there is a specific calculation for this, small, easy one, not too difficult. And this requires a knowledge of knowing what Tithi is. So if Shiva is in the cremation ground, many rituals which relate to peace, harmony, etc. cannot be done. Though you may be able to do a ritual to cure somebody of a disease. If Shiva is, so like this, tithi is absolutely vital. In fact, the five, the panchanga, not just panchanga, even I would say that having at least a fundamental idea of Jyotisha, and I'm not talking about individual horoscopy, that what is my future going to be, not like that. At least the nine grahas, the basic characteristics of those nine grahas and the 12 rashis is immensely useful in perhaps any sadhana, but in tantra sadhana even more.
Are there physical signs in the body or behavior of people who are destined to practice tantric system?
Yeah, there are physical signs, but I think this is something that I am not keen to speak about in public. But these should be learned from a guru. There are specific signs in the body for both men and women that can tell you. Somebody who is an expert, if he knows to read the signs, can tell you that who is capable, who is fit for this. Because everything, the body that you, the logic is that the body that you get at this birth, not just your family or circumstances, your mind, etc., specifically more your body that you have, is also a result of the actions that you might have performed. So if you have had an interest in past life in this path and you have done some, you know, practices in this, you will automatically be governed and be driven to finding, you know, again this path and again doing this. So accordingly, your body will also be in tune with it.
Does tantra have any foundation in Atharva Veda?
Yeah, that is a popular belief. Many people believe that tantra does have a link to the Atharva Veda. In fact, perhaps there are certain specific forms of deity, certain forms of Durga specifically, not the standard Durga Upasana that we do. Certain forms like the Asuri Durga and others, which do have a link to the Atharva Veda. There is no doubt about it. Now, that also brings us to the question, and perhaps this is what scholars who are more into the, you know, Vedic scholarship, they may be able to answer this. When did the Atharva Veda originate, or whether it was parallel to the other Vedas, whether it came later, etc. But indeed, there are practices, what in Tantra is known as Prayogas. Atharva Veda does have a lot of them. There are certain deities which were there from the Atharva Veda, which are also present in the Tantras. So, look at it this way. As I mentioned, I mean, forget the Atharva Veda. Even for the normal Vedic, the Yajurveda and all that, when the Rudra Prashna and the other ways in which the Rudram you do for Shiva, this is the Vedic way of approaching Rudra, right? Shiva. So, same Shiva also comes in the Tantras. There is the Tantric way of worship of the deity. There is then cremation ground, the Kapalika way of worship of the deity. The deity is the same. You are only changing the path. That's all.
Isha Kapoor is asking, you were co-author of a research paper which broadly covered how Tantra can be bridged with contemporary neuroscience research. Yes. To what extent the effect of Tantra-based research on neuropsychology of the practitioner can be subjected to neuroscience research? For example, will the functional MRI of a highly realized person show different interconnections of brain areas than a normal person?
There is, all I can say is that there is, that research paper was still at the very introductory level, and even to get that published, specifically the, I was a co-author, the main author, we had to go through a lot of, you know, bouts of working over it, etc. As usual, there is a certain degree of resistance to accepting of certain ideas still. I believe that there is a lot of scope for this, provided, but there is one paucity in this whole problem. One, you know, major, what do you call it, major deficiency in this research, though there is a huge amount of scope. The deficiency is that the people who are actually really high up, and, you know, nature has been very kind, I've met a few of those people, they are absolutely not interested in entering into in a state of experimentation or, you know, anybody else doing to check and all that, which I believe is also, I can understand their perspective. As a as an upasaka, you will understand why they said no to this, but that's a loss for the larger you know, community. And because we live in a time where anything that gets the scientific tag immediately becomes self-validating ki bahut acha ho gaya. So then perhaps if there was more research done on these things, there would have been you know, we would have perhaps understood at least the biological aspect of how these things function. So there is, if we look at the, if I look at a human being from the spiritual point of view, that is a little different from the way a science or a, you know, a scientist looks at a human being from the biological point of view. So there are certain, take a simple example. You look at it, say that if you ask a scientist, perhaps somebody who's more knowledgeable, he'll tell you that. So if you ask, why do you feel anger? Why do you feel happiness? Why do you fall in love with somebody? So you may say there are certain hormones working in your brain, or this or that is happening, and there's certain chemicals going around. This is what it is. That bit is true. But how do you define, for example, that you like a specific person and you dislike B specific person? That is the area where there is a lot of sublime, you know, a zone that goes beyond the standard cause and effect understanding of the world that science has at this moment. And science does wonderful in its own domain, but a human being is more complicated than that. So I believe that definitely there is a huge scope of research. Whether it will happen or not, I don't know. There have been some researches done using certain Buddhist monks of, you know, they have attained to certain, they have demonstrated certain abilities under test conditions. There were papers and all that published. But in India, the difficulty, as I said, is people who are capable, they don't even want to expose themselves to the ordinary people, what to speak of going to a group of scientists and, you know, demonstrating that. So that forms a kind of barrier for these things. But let's hope for the best going ahead. Or if somebody who's, you know, who's very well versed in science, I mean, in this paper, my perspective was from the spiritual side of things. So who's well versed in science, who can design an effective, experiment to find out that what changes biological and otherwise, or what that can be recorded in a human body that happen when certain states are experienced or certain things are demonstrated or certain such aspects. Perhaps we may have a scope for at least opening up the field to acknowledge that there is something beyond what we understand of the material world. Because in any case, human beings are material on one plane, but we are not entirely material. There is emotions, there's feelings, there's this, that, there's culture. That is how we have art, culture, and all these things. I mean, this is common sense. We all know that. History of civilization is, science is a part of it, very important, but it's not the entire part of it, etc. To have an understanding of that, using from the material perspective, is useful up to a point. From the upasaka's point of view, it is not useful, but perhaps from the scientist's point of view, from a, it may open up avenues. So that's all I can say at the moment.